So what we've done is sort of taken those complete external dimensions and put a whole electric drivetrain system in that box and replicated the functionality and features of a diesel power system in an electric version. So this system, it includes the battery, it's got the motors in there, the inverters, a charging system, and all the controls and supervisory logic that goes on top of it. And it also mimics an engine in multiple other ways as well. So the mounting points are in the same locations. The sort of center line of where rotational power comes out is in the same place as you'd find on an engine, and we have the same interface as well. So all very familiar for the OEM.
This is Greg Schultz here with Charge. We're at day one at Bauma, and right now we are at the Perkins booth. I'm excited to be talking to Paul Muller, technical sales manager from Perkins. Obviously, the world is changing and evolving quite rapidly and off-highway, and Perkins has been known as an advanced power system supplier in this industry for a long time. Great opportunity to speak with you and kind of get your view on where the industry is today, you know, maybe a bit of the journey as equipment is beginning to electrify or at least look into alternative power systems. Yeah. And your company is helping to work with OEMs to kind of help guide them through this journey and provide them with the solutions that they need both today and into the future. Would you mind giving us kind of an idea of what that journey has looked like and how you're helping OEMs navigate the new waters?
Yeah, so Greg, it's great having you here. And yeah, Perkins, we've been known for a long time, like you said, on our advanced power systems, our advanced engines, you know. Perkins has been around 90 plus years doing mainly diesel engines. But the world's changing. You know, there's different options coming around. There's different alternatives. And we're trying to work with our OEMs to look at how we can offer them different options and explore the different opportunities for different ways of powering their machines in the future. And this isn't about sort of stopping doing what we've been doing on diesel. You know, there's still room to go there. We're still looking at how we can improve and optimize that side of it. But we're very aware that there's other alternatives out there, and we also want to aid our OEM customers on trying to find and explore those options and seeing where those power systems make more sense for their application and their end user customers, and where other power systems make more sense as well. So as part of that, you know, for quite a while now, we've been just doing on the simple sort of side of things of looking at drop-in fuels that can be used in our diesel engines, things like HVO. Does reduce the overall life cycle carbon emissions from it. But now we're sort of moving into other areas of looking at like the more alternate fuels, things like hydrogen, methanol, ethanol, biomethane, for example, and also into sort of full electric systems as well. And, you know, for all these different power systems, all these different fuels, there's a place for each of them, and we're trying to work out how they fit together. And there's also quite often some overlap between them. So, for instance, looking at both diesel and also alternate fuels, you know, hybridization, you know, taking the advantages of electrification, adding it into the sort of long range, the getting rid of that sort of range anxiety side, even in off-highway people have, and adding it into the diesel or the alt fuel to then give people those benefits, reduce their overall fuel consumption, give them the confidence that they're going to be able to get a whole job done in a day. So, yeah, a plethora of different things. And looking at all of them at the same time.
Yeah, and I think one of the things that's been really interesting as we've talked more is that you don't take that prescriptive approach to say, this is what we're going to do with power systems and you need to figure out how to utilize that in the equipment that you have. You've been very collaborative with the OEMs. Is that fair to say?
It is. Collaboration is a big part of our DNA that we want to do. You know, we like working with our customers. They bring a huge amount of insight to us that we're not going to get. And us pretending that we know how their customers work, how their end users work, isn't right. So by understanding the OEM, understanding their end user and getting their feedback has helped us decide what we should be focusing on and looking at. And we've got a few different projects that we're doing at the moment that are really sort of trying to take that approach and looking at how we can make the application and the adoption of alternatives like alternative fuels simpler. Things like hydrogen, we're looking at industrial open power units, as we call them, where we are including like the hybrid system, the cooling pack, all the bits they need in a single package that allows them to almost drop that in. And now we're starting to do the same on electrification as well. And it's really about trying to make the adoption more straightforward for the OEMs, because there's a lot of change out there.
Absolutely.
While still, you know, working with the DNA, working with the things that we've done in the past, and taking those benefits.
Right, and that's huge, because if it's too much of a challenge, if it's too much of a hurdle for them, that makes adopting the new technology less likely to happen.
Exactly.
And you know, that we all, I think, have a vision of the world we'd like to live in the future. And if we're going to get there, we have to make it palatable for them.
Yeah, and it's looking at where some of these technologies can give you advantages today, and therefore
Absolutely.
Make them so they're just the best choice. It's not I'm moving away from diesel, it's I'm just making the best choice. And even Absolutely. Within sort of like looking at diesel hybrid, we've had a project that we've been running over in Peter in the UK where Perkins is based, around a hybridized telehandler. And that's got, you know, we see some really good fuel consumption savings in sort of day-to-day running. But we've added the capability that you can actually switch the engine off and run it in full electric mode. And then that allows you to do things like drive indoors with it. So now you've sort of gone from a situation where you're using maybe this telehandler to move things outdoors, and then you have to put it on the ground, wait for a forklift truck to come along, pick it up, and then you can move it indoors to, well, I just switch the engine off, I can carry on. And, you know, you've made logistics operations more efficient, and they're always looking for those efficiency benefits. So the hybridization becomes just a better system rather than specifically a hybrid. It's about, okay, that's the best solution for me, that's why I'm doing it. Got a full electrification project where, you know, it opens up the opportunity to use that machine in underground mines where they don't want exhaust fumes of any kind, whether that's diesel, hydrogen, whatever. They just don't want the exhaust.
Sure.
So by doing a full electric version, but doing it in a way that's easy for them to do, it allows them to adopt it and actually to try it out and get the feedback and see if they want to do more of it, or whether it wasn't the right solution and they want to go in a different direction. So yeah, really looking at all those things.
Excellent. So folks, stick around a little bit more. You've heard a little bit about the vision and where we're going, how they're helping to address some challenges. We're about to learn more about specific solutions and hear more about what's available today. Don't miss. All right, Greg Schultz, Charged EVs. We are back at Bauma. I'm joined again by Paul Muller from Perkins. In our last conversation, we talked about kind of the vision of power systems and how Perkins is really helping OEMs through the journey that power systems is undertaking and off-highway. Now we're going to dive into a little bit more detail, and we're going to talk about some specific options that are available today and what the best use cases for this equipment is. So, Paul, if you wouldn't mind telling us a little bit more what we're standing in front of, give us some details on where that's used, what the best use case is for it, that would be great.
No, it's great to have you back here and, you know, go through this. So we stood in front of our battery electric power unit. So this is a new thing. This is first time we're showing this here at Bauma. Unveiled it on Monday, and here it is. And it's a really interesting concept, this. So, you know, one of the barriers for adoption for people to make the move to electrification is just the amount of sort of R&D, the amount of training, the amount of safety work that they need to do. And this, you know, companies look at it, especially sort of small and medium-sized OEMs, and say, is it really worth me putting that investment in? They might have those opportunities. They might have had customers asking about electric solutions and zero tailpipe solutions, but they're thinking, is it worth us doing that investment? It's only a small number of machines. It's not the main sort of day-to-day stuff they're going to sell in. So what we've tried to do here is basically package it all inside a box. You know, this unit, the battery electric power unit, it's the same size in terms of its overall dimensions as our 904, so 3.6 litre engined industrial power unit. And the industrial power unit means it's got a cooling pack on the front, includes the after treatment on the top, and a sort of skid that it's all mounted on. So what we've done is sort of taken those complete external dimensions and put a whole electric drivetrain system in that box and replicated the functionality and features of a diesel power system in an electric version. So this system, it includes the battery, it's got the motors in there, the inverters, a charging system, and all the controls and supervisory logic that goes on top of it. And it also mimics an engine in multiple other ways as well. So the mounting points are in the same locations. The sort of center line of where rotational power comes out is in the same place as you'd find on an engine, and we have the same interface as well. So all very familiar for the OEMs. And, you know, one of the big challenges they'd have would be around the sort of electrical integration. So we stayed with the J1939 type connections, the interfacing that we use. And also this is able to mimic some of the inputs and outputs of an engine. So the key switch connection will turn it on, the throttle will change the speed, we also like can output an oil pressure signal. So if the machine won't allow operation till it sees oil pressure, this outputs an oil pressure signal even though there's no oil in it.
Oh, wow.
So it does all these things just to make that integration and changeover easy. And you know, it means an OEM can make, you know, one of these and just put the system in, and everything else can be exactly the same as their diesel, all their interface, all the way the operator uses it, all exactly the same, but now they have a zero tailpipe solution. So it really allows them to try things out. It allows our customers to say, we want to give this a go. We want to try electrification. We want to see whether customers see the benefit from it and really do that. You know, and that's going to allow things like maybe there's a use case where they want to use it indoors, or, you know, the machine we've got here is a pipe fusion machine. It's used to join plastic pipe together for water. And the OEM who makes this McElroy, they've got some opportunities with like underground mining. And obviously the underground mines are like, if we could have a zero emissions one, a zero tailpipe, that'd be really useful for us. So this gives them the opportunity, while still keeping their core business around diesel, to see if it takes off and see what changes and see how things move over time.
Right. So this may be a silly question, or maybe it isn't, but it seems like a drop-in solution. Is this something that could also be used for maybe OEMs that are a little hesitant to do it today, but they... down the road, they want to have that option to swap out a powertrain?
Definitely, yeah, it can be. And so way of sort of future protecting you. If they take our engine today, they can sort of future protect because the hookup points are the same. It also takes away some of those sort of concerns around, you know, am I still going to be able to get that particular motor if I buy it from that supplier or that inverter or whatever? Because really the concept here is the box. The sort of idea we're selling is the box. What's inside it ends up being quite unimportant to the OEM and the end user. You know, Perkins will support it. We'll probably over time change components from inside this, but as long as the power still comes out at the same place and the interface stays the same, it's not the problem for them. And it really gives them that, removing their concerns about, you know, is the company still going to be in business in a few years' time and things like that. We can stand behind it and support it further into the future. And yeah, that's a real, I think, gives a lot of peace of mind to OEMs. And also gives them more confidence to try things out, and that's the whole piece of it. You know, this particular unit, the way we've got it set up, we get like 75 kilowatts of power, electrical power out of it, but we can actually configure it to have like just a high voltage output if you want to use like an electric power takeoff, an EPTO type system. Various different ways we configure it, adding more energy in and looking at that. So you know, we've done a significant amount of work with this particular model. We took a lot of data. They use our engine today, so we took a lot of data, used our telematics, used our electronic engines that we can pull data from to understand the real-world usage of this. And the battery we have in here, which is the 64 kilowatt-hour, 600-volt battery, the same one as we've talked about in previous discussions and at previous shows, you know, we feel this will power this machine for a day, and you'd get a useful day's work out of this machine without really changing how you're operating it.
That's huge. I mean, that's definitely a hurdle that gets in the way of some people looking into electrification because they're worried if they're going to get the same working day out of it. And so it's always huge when we can address those concerns up front. You're going to be able to use the equipment as you would normally.
Exactly. And we can work with OEMs on that. We can download the data. You know, we can look at how they use a diesel version today. And we can advise them on it. In some applications, it's not going to be suitable, and we can tell them that it's not going to be suitable.
Sure.
You know, we're working in other areas as well. We've got a project going on at the moment called Project COAS, which is looking at a multiple fuels. So the spark ignite engines, we're looking at like methanol, ethanol, methane, and then we're going to demonstrate that particular engine on hydrogen. So, you know, we might say electric's not for you, but maybe if you want to find a different solution that's going to reduce your tailpipe emissions, reduce your overall life cycle carbon, maybe a hydrogen engine's a solution.
Sure.
We can talk about that. And it's, I think, a real strength of what Perkins are doing is that we can talk about all the options. We're not trying to push people down a single route and can try and advise them and then actually mean that the customer's happy and the end user gets to do what they need to do. Like you said, doing a day's work is what they're there for. You know,
right.
People don't run these machines for fun. They're doing them to get jobs done and to earn money and to, you know, make people's lives better. So that's what we're trying to help.
Yeah, at the end of the day, that's what it's all about. If we can't do that, then, you know, we can have all the concerns about removing emissions that we want to, but if the equipment doesn't do what it's designed to do, it's never going to be adopted.
Exactly. And we want people to adopt for the right reason. We want people to do it because it gives them more flexibility, gives them more options and more opportunities, you know, like I said, using this indoors or underground or whatever, you know.
this can open up some new opportunities that OEMs have previously gone, there's not really the market for that. It's too difficult, too hard for us to do that. This solution, what we're also doing with Lycoas, with the sort of power unit there as well, opens up some of those doors and therefore gives them more opportunities to go into new areas that they haven't thought about before.
Right. And I love the idea that this is all an all-encased solution that cuts down on the R&D time. They don't have to re-engineer the product to fit around a new power system. It's all there for them.
Definitely. And from a safety point of view, you know, we spend a lot of time thinking about the safety of the system, you know, including this like a little cover here where you can take that cover off and you can check everything is dead before you take it out. So we can make sure that the safety's incorporated in it. You know, safety's a big part of that. And it's, again, another concern that OEMs have talked to us about, that they're worried about the safety side with high voltage. So we've really thought about that right from the start in this design.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much. We really appreciate all the information. For our viewers, we are going to provide some links if you'd like to find out some more information. So check the comments there. Once again, Paul, thank you so much for your time.
Appreciate it.